Well, thank you, everyone. Good morning. Say before I'm Dan Yoretta, a bit about myself. I'm a junior high teacher. I teach at Southwest Junior High full-time, and I'm an adjunct professor. And as I stated before, I currently completed my master's in literature and writing, mainly focusing on Latino writers from all the way from Chile, all the way up to Mexico, and Cuba, and Dominican Republic, and so on. And because of that, that's why I would like to present what I have written today. In regards to what I'm presenting today is dealing with cultural identity and dealing with the reflection of that culture in Latino literature. And it's very important to take consideration what this reflects. Often when we think about literature, we take it from the Western point of view, the European, as well as the Northern, the United States point of view of literature, that it has to follow these segmented styles or this type of expectations to make a literature. And because of that, when it comes to Latino literature, it doesn't reflect those expectations often. It doesn't. Because in Latino literature, it is a reflection of a different culture. A culture that often I tell one of my professors and I tell my wife that is very divergent from the American culture in this respect. In my essay, I discussed about how when it comes to those facets, perspective, especially when it comes to technology and religion, it becomes very different. In the United States, and I say this with a bit trepidation, I guess, but the science is basically God of the United States, that everything is around the realm of science, that if you don't go along with it, then it doesn't exist. You do have religion and faith and spirituality, but it's its own domain. In Mexico and other parts of Latin America, that reflection is very different. You can have a doctor that have his very favorite saint, and he always bless a saint before he does some type of procedure and so forth. You also have scientists that don't believe in God, but you also have people that that practice curandismo, which is a form of spirituality, and they have no conflict with science whatsoever. And that curandismo is a misnegation, a mixture of all these different facets of psychology, spirituality, and of medicinal practices, dealing with herbs and massages and those facets. So the presentation I have for you today reflects that in two pieces of literature. The first piece of literature, over the major themes. The major themes that I'll be going over are family, religion, faith and spirituality, and identity and community. And I'll be using two novels to explicate these facets. The first one is by Rodolfo Anaya called Bless Me Ultima. It's a very, very good book. I love it so much. I have yet to see the movie, though. It's on my to-watch list. It focuses on the life of Antonio Mares and a search for identity, questioning and examining his faith in God, Catholicism, curandismo, and the ancient practices of the indigenous belief. And the reason that it deals with family religion is because in the novel, I hate to spoil it for everyone, I apologize. Antonio Mares, he grows up in a traditional Catholic family. There, the expectation of the families that you go to Catholic church, you go to communion, you go through those steps of life. In the process, he meets a curandera. That curandera is Ultima. And Ultima takes him on this journey of self-reflection and questioning and to identify who he is and what he believes in. And this reflects his family as well. He's torn apart by the two expectations of his parents. His mom, a Luna, they go with the phases of the moon. They're farmers and ranchers. Traditionally, they go with the Catholic Church, and they respect the establishment of the church. The Mares side, his father's side, is of the Elianos, the plains, and they are cowboys, and they are free-spirited. They go with the wild horses. They don't have much faith in church, but they have more faith in humans and of nature. So he doesn't know what to do, and he has these very profound and at times very disturbing dreams about who he is. And often he either sees everything destroyed or recreated, and at times Ultima, the curandera, comes in to intervene. And that's why family religion becomes a huge facet, because within Latino culture, in many parts of it, the family becomes a central point, like every other culture. But often, and this is from my experience growing up as a Mexican, you don't have to leave the house at 18. You could stay there and go to school and wait to either get married, you find a job, you decide to live on your own, or you get an education. But you don't have to leave. And you always are expected to come back. And you always are to remember the roots, your past history because of that. Now, when it comes to religion, though, again, it's the expectation. If you're not Catholic, you might be in trouble within the family sometimes. It depends on those scenarios. Now, the entire family converted, let's say, to a different sect of Christianity, that's fine. But if someone diverges from that path, again, that could create conflict. Now, again, this is not reflective of every Mexican or every Latino. Just as Americans complex, America itself, so is Mexico and every Latin country. So with that, we go to the next slide. And this is, and I brought this up, and I should have brought this up earlier about curandismo. Curandismo is the healing tradition found in Mexico. The curandera or curandero, female and male respectively, heal their patients by accepting three facets of health: spiritual, psychological, and physical. And this is where it connects to religion as well, and the different reflection of, perspective of culture. As I stated before, in the United States, often science is seen as the ultimate thing, that's what we try to aspire to. And that's great, it is. But in Mexico, and this is something I tell my professor, Mexico's the land where God, the devil, witches, and gnomes still tread the land. People still believe that there is a witch. I mean, where my family's from, there is a small town where they say, es puro brujas, there's only witches there. It's like, really? Do you go to school? You know, there's like, you know, it's a college, it's a Hogwarts for, you know, Mexico. You know? I would go, I would love to do that, you know, so. But joking aside, it's actually quite fascinating because that's very different from the American point of view. Gnomes and witches are reserved for fantasy novels. And in Mexico, no, it's part of life. Next to, let's say, internet cafe with Wi-Fi signal. And next to that, you have a surgeon's office. And next to that, you have un curandero, who probably visits the Wi-Fi, the surgeon, and all those individuals. And it's important to understand what curandismo is. It is a miscegenation of very different practices. African practices brought in from the slaves during the slave trade, and where Spain brought in huge amounts of slaves during that time period. It also takes in from Hippocrates' texts on medicine. It also takes in the works and practices of the Europeans and of people that were considered witches, but they were herbal healers, and as well as the Native American practices of herbal healing and those spiritual facets. And because of that, they mix those three things together. With the curandero or curandera, more often it is a curandera, a female, they incorporate Catholicism, spirituality, it incorporates science, and the person does take on those three roles. It becomes a psychologist, a doctor, and a priest. And often those curanderos, what they will do is that while they massage your muscles, often they'll say a prayer, un credo, the Nicene Creed, or Padre Nuestro, the Our Father. And because of that reality, it's not uncommon for some students or for young adults, and it's actually, I think it's in the HMO plan, I'm not sure, Blue Shield, Blue Cross, I have to check on that, that it is practice, and the people can go get a limpieza, they'll get a cleansing, get rid of the negative energies because the evil eye that someone placed on them, and they're good to go. And it's common. And because of that reflection, that reality exists, and that reality, just because it exists, creates that confrontation with the northern expectation of literature. When you have a piece of literature where, and it incorporates magical realism, where magic is made mundane and everything that is mundane is made marvelous, it creates a conflict because some people may not like it. And sometimes it is intentional, sometimes it is not. But that confrontation does exist because it doesn't adhere to those expectations and rules. So when it comes to literature, especially Latino literature, it focuses on those facets, a different reality that is not in unison with most of the United States or Europe. It becomes its own world. Now, the other piece of literature I do wish to explicate on more is Tomas Rivera's And the Earth Not Devour Him, Y No Se Trago La Tierra. And this is the one I use within the essay that I presented. In this essay, it takes a different path, and it's very fascinating. I love this story, and I don't want to read it again at times because it's so painful. There's moments when I read it and think, oh my gosh, I want to read it. No, I don't. Okay, I'll do. I regret it. Okay, don't regret it. I loved it. I love the novel, and it's so well done. This novel tells the story of an unnamed protagonist and the realities of American farm workers during the 1940s and 50s through vignettes. These vignettes reflect thoughts and events of the unnamed protagonist and the migrant farm workers of his community. His journey occurs in the halls of dreams as he sleeps and discovers his true name. And this is where it becomes fascinating. Again, it doesn't adhere to the expectations of traditional literature. And I do wish to explicate this a little bit more further. Permit me. This one follows the traditional Bildungsroman style of writing. The boy's discovering himself. He goes to these events and journeys, and he develops and finds himself in the end. Here, though, it doesn't. Here, the story is a circular narrative story, where the beginning is the ending. So, again, spoilers, I'm sorry. The boy goes, and you never know the boy's name. He goes under the house, he falls asleep, and that's where he goes on this journey of listening to everybody's voices. It'll be his neighbors, it'll be his parents, it'll be his own reflections about faith, and losing his faith and finding himself. And in that journey, he identifies with the people of his community. And that becomes something very central, where he becomes the voice that, I should rephrase this. Through the journey, the events of the people in the community become his identity. And thus, he becomes the community himself. It becomes a circular nature. The whole thing has circles in it. The narrative story has a circular path. His own journey of listening to everybody's voices and listening to his, he becomes them and they, and he becomes them and they become him. And he becomes a voice for his people in this story, in this novel. And the parts I reflected upon is the total antithesis of Antonio Mares. Because Antonio Mares is finding his faith by creating his own ideology. When it comes to Antonio Mares and Bless Me Ultima, he's dealing with the golden carp that he sees, which is a reflection of indigenous beliefs, Catholicism, and curandismo. And he says, you know what? I can merge them together and have become my new belief. Here, the unnamed protagonist abandons that. As I pointed out on page 3 of it, on the Silvery Night, he talks about how he calls out the devil and no one answers. And then he says, well, there's no devil, then there's no, I better not say it. And so right there, he keeps that revelation to himself. Whether it's true or not, it really doesn't matter. It's his truth, his reality. And that's where this reality becomes important, because it's a reflection of his perspective. Now, when it comes to Latino literature, I can go more and more in depth. I mean, there's so much. I mean, I actually took out a couple more slides, because the last time I did something with a similar presentation, it took me like an hour to go through everything. And even then, there was stuff left over I didn't go into. So it's like, okay, I have to cut some stuff out. And it was really painful. But because of that, I think that reflects a lot more what Latino literature is and what people may, and some individuals may not accept of it. That it is confrontational, purposely a confronts the societal expectations of literature. And it's interesting because when I was studying my literature, the books I needed to read for my master's, I saw many different people's expectations of it. Some people said it's great. Others said it's perverted. It's like, really? I wonder why. I should buy it then. I mean, if it really offends people, that's the literature I need to buy. So I looked for it, and I found out that it is not perverted. It is not offensive. It is offensive to some senses because it is brutally honest. For example, here, one of the passages deals with a truck that was driving in the middle of the night. It flips over, and around 16 people die, burning in flames, because these people are migrant farm workers. And they worry more about the driver than the 16 that were burned alive, men, women, and children. And then there's another story where a boy goes to get a drink of water, but he's 8 and he's working the fields. So as he goes to get a drink of water, the boss thinks he's a deer, shoots him in the head and kills him. And then the boy's forgotten. The man goes insane, and that's the end of the story. And that is a reflection of the occurrences that go on. Any questions? Oh, I apologize. Just for completion, my apologies. This is the last slide. Latino novel and memoir writing is suffused with the culture, history, religion, sexuality of a culture whose own mixing created a new identity, a mestizaje, a mixture of realities that's ancient and real in the kingdom of this world. So I do appreciate you, everyone listening and taking time to come in, and I'm ready for questions.
Okay, I'm really happy to see that you have this universalist mm-hmm. views, because I grew up with that mind, okay, with universalist, even in the village. Mm-hmm. They used to tell us this, that there is only one world, mm-hmm. one God, one sun, one moon, mm-hmm. okay? It's only when I started going to Europe that I realized all these divisions and so on, because, you see, my background is not like that, okay? Is that if you eat, you need to think about you need to think that others also will have to eat. You don't need to eat I don't know, 2 or 3 years ahead. Mm-hmm. You see what I mean? Mm-hmm. Okay, now, it's here, look, you and I used to talk about this, literature,
yes, yes.
It's all the time in summertime, especially when I was teaching English 102, and then I had my student read this, Never Marry a Mexican.
It's fiction.
Exactly. Who is that? Sandra Cisneros. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then we even talked about the how do you call that stuff again? Is the metaphor? Or did you remember the metaphor?
Yes, okay,
the key and the lock. Because yes. Look, everything was based on what? Everything was based on infidelity. It's kind of a fictional stuff and
yes,
so on. Okay,
yes.
And then I explained that stuff to you, saying mm-hmm. that from the African point of view, mm-hmm. they always say that it's up to women, okay, to save the marriage. You understand? Yeah, it is true. I mean, even here, look, Hillary Clinton, in fact, saved the marriage.
That's
the,
true.
The wife of Schwarzenegger they didn't want to save her marriage, okay? Mm-hmm. And then they separated. You see what I mean? Because to come back to the metaphor of mm-hmm. the key and the lock, mm-hmm. okay, which is exactly widespread. I mean, now it's even here, okay? Mm-hmm. It goes like this, that if you have a key that can open so many doors, how do you call that key?
A used key, yeah.
Yeah, that is exactly the master key. But mm-hmm. if you have a lock, okay, that can be opened by any key.
Yes.
Are you safe? Can you leave your stuff in the house?
True.
No,
true.
You can't, because yes. any key can come and open. You see, that explains exactly everything. Now, here, what I noticed, okay, mm-hmm. as I listened to you from mm-hmm. start exactly to finish, I realized exactly that literature is always about what? It's about commentary and criticism of society.
Yes, yes, exactly.
No, I mean, no matter whether it's oral mm-hmm. or written, mm-hmm. it's always exactly like that. Okay, now, this is exactly how I'm going to finish, because you even talked about La Curandera and so on. See, that stuff even existed. When I was in my undergraduate study, okay, we studied Chaucer and so on, okay, so all the stuff, okay, fortune teller, all the mm-hmm. stuff and so on. You see that stuff exactly through literature.
Exactly,
okay?
Yes.
And what is the last point? What's the last point? I'm kind of losing the train of thought here. No, yeah, exactly. It should be a question. And now I try to think of the last question here is, or comment. Where is that? No, I lost it. I mean, it doesn't matter. Okay. Oops, I'm not the only one to do that stuff.
No,
okay.
No,
yeah,
I guess.
It also happened in Texas, remember? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, it might come back.
Yes, that's fine.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel, so much. This was really, really interesting. And I wanted to point out one of the things that you sort of emphasized mm-hmm. in your presentation is something that I'm going to emphasize in mine too, which
yes.
is self-reflection and questioning and
yes.
self-awareness,
mm-hmm.
right? Which
yes.
which I think is a really nice tie together of two completely different subject
yes,
matters,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly.
I also wanted to say that I love the way that you phrased that juxtaposition of magical realism, how mm-hmm. the magical becomes mundane mm-hmm. and the mundane becomes magical.
Mm-hmm.
I had never thought of it that way, and I love that, and I'm stealing it because it's beautiful, and I love it because it's so true,
yes,
you know,
yes.
and it's such a simple way of putting something so complex to get across.
Yes, yes.
And then my other question, I did have a question for you. One of the things that's striking me as I hear you talk, and then I think about, you know, our Western canon,
mm-hmm.
Is in our Western canon, we seem to emphasize the rugged individualism, right?
Yes.
Rugged individual will go off from family and go off and
yes.
make their own way, et cetera,
yeah.
right? Whereas what you seem to be expressing about Latino literature is that there's not so much that rugged individualism as community as individual.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say that's correct, or is that far, I mean, I know that that's really limiting and simplistic,
Yeah, actually, that's a question that I came to a conclusion as well. Because in the beginning of my studies, that was one of the things I was noticing as well. When I read House on Mango Street, Richard Rodriguez, Hunger of Memory, when I read Cien Años de Soledad, 100 Years of Solitude, and all these different facets, I was thinking, okay, it seems to be that the American idealism, such as with Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn, and all these other great novels, the individual says, excuse my language, screw everything, I'm heading off to the West or doing this. And here, it becomes very different. It becomes where it becomes this chronology of family stories. The House of Spears, 100 Years of Solitude, and other novels, they become chronologies of families, of their exploits and their adventures. And then here, when it comes to these novels, the person becomes a reflection of that community. Now, this becomes very complex, and I have to be careful with what I say right now. In many cases, yes. It becomes the person is attached to the community. There are moments where it's the individual is isolated and they have to struggle on their own. But often, very often, is connection with family, connection with that community. And something to connect with this, right? I think it's so funny. There are so many kitchen scenes I read in the novels. So many scenes in the kitchen. And I think about my own times in Mexico where the kitchen, the door is always open from like 8 in the morning to 10, 11 o'clock at night. People are coming in, grabbing a bite, they're talking, they're leaving. And it just becomes a giant revolutions of ideas. And it's fun. And I find it so powerful that, and so different that instead of the American perspective where it's individualism, in Latino literature, you have the individual, but they are connected to the community. And they are a reflection of their events, that they're never truly separate from anything. They are the product of their society. So actually, that's a very good question. That was one that I had in my mind as well.
Which I think is a really beautiful thing, you know, and shows really a contrast between what Americans are taught to value, right? Mm-hmm. Or United States citizens are taught to value versus the culture of Mexico and Latin American cultures where your community is central to who you are and who you become and how you become who you become as an individual versus in the United States, it's you.
Yeah.
It's you. And so I think, you know, I know I see that playing out in my classrooms with my students. You know, they have these very close family relationships and it's difficult for me to relate to because, you know, I turned 18. I did most stuff by myself at home. I was an only child. And then it was college, kicked out, go make your own way, girl, you know, kind of a thing. And so I think it's a beautiful juxtaposition, but I also think that there's a lot that we have to learn about the value of community and family from this, which is why I'm really excited that a lot more people are focusing their studies on this. So thank you.
No, thank you.
Do you have a final thought to end your presentation?
I'm sorry, did you have a comment?
I want to say something about what Anne-Marie just said, because you see that individualism exists exactly everywhere. I mean, if you read, for instance, Chinua Achebe, you see that stuff, individualism and the community. It is kind of two competing forces. Now, in the African cultures like this, you are responsible for what you are doing, but make sure that you do the right thing, because if you mess up, it's going to affect not only your family, but also the community.
True,
exactly.
Very true.
Yeah. This is kind of a two-way street, but
Things fall apart.
I remember I read that novel, Fall Apart, three times, for my undergraduate studies, because it was I gave you that stuff, how the African novel is divided, with colonial injustice, freedom is a nightmare, and then each time we have to read for instance Chinua Achebe, because it was kind of a seminal work.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We have a question. We're extending your time because everyone's so engaged.
Excellent.
Yeah, I mean, it's completely against my nature to be rebellious, and I don't want to, upset Liz's structure or anything, but I figure it's a pretty small audience here, so we probably can stretch things out a little bit. And that's just a preface to the fact that I don't have anything at all to say, really. But I just wanted to completely go off on a tangent and compliment Daniel for, you know, his dynamic demeanor and all that kind of stuff. And I was really impressed, and I'm looking forward to Daniel being able to teach 101 and 102 now for us down in South County and stuff like that. Okay, so there's, you know, all kinds of possibilities that are coming out of this, I guess you could say. But just a couple of random things, you know, as I was listening to you, and bless me, Ultima, you know, I was just so shocked one time to see that on a list of books that had been removed.
Oh, from the from, Tucson, wasn't
from,
it?
From, well, and from different places.
Schools,
it's actually been removed from the libraries of public schools and stuff like that, and it just fit in so well with what you said about it being confrontational, because people see it as being, you know, a pagan and all these different kinds of things, you know. Because the pagan really seems to rise above just a little bit there, doesn't it? Isn't that right? The Yano rises above the Luna a little bit in that book.
Mm-hmm. We have a United States rugged individualism as long as it's, you know, based on Christian.
Right, and that was the other kind of random comment I wanted to make. It just tied in so well, because last night in my film class I showed Mi Familia, because you're talking about the value of family and the value of community and stuff like that. And I'm casting around for questions to ask in the discussion board, and you just suggested several really good things. You know, how is the Anglo ethic a little bit different from the Latino ethic? And and so I can, you know, run back to my office and stick that into the discussion board too. So thank you for that too. Anyway, those are my just random thoughts.
Any other questions? Comments? Your final thoughts?
My final thought is that it's quite fascinating when I, like, we're finishing my studies and everything, and I can't say that correctly. It's funny because when I look at my bookshelf and I look at the 20 books I've read, and then all the article and pieces of critical analysis I've read, and as well as critical essays by Alejo Campiter, Franz Rohl, and other individuals dealing with marvelous reality, magical realism, I realize my studies are not done yet. And it's funny because with the term master, like masters, you should be a master of it. And there's so many books I need to read. I mean, I'm reading, you're never done, you're never. Like right now reading Pedro Páramo, the Juan Rulfo, and he's one of the best writers in Mexico of the 20th century. And there's so much that I didn't hear about in my studies. So little came up of him. It only has 300 pages of work, and I'm going through it in Spanish so I can improve my Spanish. And it's so complex, so much in just a small sentence. And I think that reflects about Latino literature. As I state in my essay, I cannot generalize everything that I state right here because it goes so complex into it. I once I saw an interview with Gabriel Quesada Márquez, and if you can find it on YouTube, it's funny and hilarious and profound, where he discusses his inspirations. And he talks about his pride in Colombian literature. And God knows how much is there. Then you go to Isabel Allende from Chile, dealing with the golpe de Estado, the coup d'etat of, you know, the military taking over. And there's so much there. And then you go to Mexico with Jose Vasconcelos, the raza cosmica, the cosmic race. Then you go to Cristina Garcia's in Cuba, Dreaming in Cuban. And there's Santeria mixed in there as well. So it's almost as I feel like I do an injustice just focusing on these two novels, when there's so much fecundity, so much that I can pry my hands into and get what I can get, because it's fun. It really is just fun. I mean, I wish I can go to more depth and existentialist, you know, profound. I can't. It's just really fun. And I really like it. So those are my final thoughts. Thank you very much, and thank you.
Well, I'm a baby. I teach in South Yuma County. See, I used to teach here on the main campus when we were living in the foothills. As I recall, I used to teach classes here at 7. But you see, each time in the afternoon, 7 a.m. here is exactly the main campus. And I always ended up teaching in San Luis in the evening because I was teaching ESL and English at the same time. Okay, now, this is the presentation today. We are... It's exactly about the need of teaching grammar in developmental English. It is very, very important, okay? And I do this based on my my own background, because there are things that we learn, okay? From the very beginning, we have two things. And this is exactly how, I'm going to explain that exactly at the end, okay? Because kids, children or students, when they learn a new language, they require two things, words and grammar. Because grammar creates meaning. They need grammar exactly to put words together and so on. They don't acquire, accent or the way of speaking. Why? Because the shape of the organ of speech and the mouth and so on. Okay, so look, everything changes. You don't talk like your parents. And the parents don't talk like their own parents, etc. Okay, so you see that stuff changes. It changes based on the ability, and then the way you talk. Okay, is exactly part of the personality. And people will recognize you based on what? On your voice, on the voice. So you see everything changes. So it starts exactly like this, understanding the problem in the developmental English. So let's focus on what? On grammar, and also integrate, we need to integrate reading and writing. This is what we'll try to do here. Let's see here. Okay. What do we have in AWC developmental education? We have reading, we have writing, and we have math. It's all about what? It's about literacy. Literacy is about reading and writing, okay? And by the way, you have four skills, and this is exactly how they are acquired. So you start first listening, and then speaking, and then reading and writing. And then also numeracy. But numeracy, this is about math, okay? I won't talk really much about that stuff. Then, so what we do here is exactly literacy and numeracy at a higher level, okay? Look, you see that a number of students join the general education program after at least four semesters of ESA, which actually teaches BICS. This is the basic interpersonal communication skill. This is conversational English. Once they can converse for us in English, then they can easily be mainstream. But at the same time, they also learn the language of the book. It's what we call CALP. Okay, this is a cognitive academic language proficiency. And then it goes like this. This is very, very crucial because in college, we read to write. So you need to know exactly how to deal with the college. Because most of the time, students fail in college, not because they're not smart. It's because of not knowing the language, but mainly the language of the book. And this is exactly the component developmental English, where developmental classes in the English component. You have English 80, 90, 100, 101, and 102. But the focus today here is on English 80 and English 90. Okay, in English 80, this is exactly following different reform that we undertook in the department, okay? So designed to review the sentence structure, okay? Why the sentence? It's because we always talk or write in sentences. That's why sentence is very, very crucial. And the grammar that we are going to talk about here is just the grammar to write a sentence. Because if you can write one sentence, you can write two. If you can write two sentences, you can write a paragraph. If you can write a paragraph, you can write a page. If you write one page, you can write also 100 pages. Before you know it, you write a book. And then English 90 is here. So it's I don't need to read all this stuff, okay? Because we know exactly what we do in English 90. It's kind of a review and reinforcement of English 80. Okay, now for all practical purposes, this is the reading component. It's really a pity that Donna is not here to try to clarify this, because this is exactly what she does teach. So in reading 90 and then actually aligns with English 80 and 90. This is reading 93. So these three courses requires what? It requires a lot of vocabulary. And more importantly, the knowledge of a word that the students exactly will encounter either when they read or when they write. And see, words are crucial because nation in fact, noted this in 1990, that the potential knowledge of a world which is rich and complex is that neither reading nor writing can achieve alone. So you need to have both at the same time in order to come to a good knowledge of a word, okay? Because if you read it, you understand it. And most of the time you can't write if you don't understand what you are reading. Now, the knowledge of a word in fact implies meaning. Okay, if you pick up the dictionary, you're going to see that words are polysemous, okay, because the dictionary provides with a lot of meaning. So it's exactly up to you to pick, okay, depending on the context, to say, oh, this is exactly what it means here in this context. And also the written form, this is exactly the spelling. Nowadays, we use the computer. Spelling is no longer a problem. We don't give dictation, okay? Because if you misspell the word, before you know it, there is a red line, and then you click a button, and the correction is done automatically. And then also the spoken form, this is exactly the phonetic transcription, okay? And then the grammatical behavior of the word, okay? This is exactly about the collocation, the association. We say to go to, but you never say to go to home. Okay, this is kind of an idiom. People need to learn all that stuff. We say complain about something, responsible for. If you use another preposition there, you screw up the meaning. Those are things that you may come to know through reading and also interaction. And also the register of the word is like this. Is like, look, learning in any field is first of all language learning, because you can learn one word. That word can be used in different subject, okay? Carrying different meaning. If you take the word case, for instance, when a lawyer, okay, talks about case, is different from the case that a medical doctor or a nurse talks about. Or it's different from a case that we talk about in the classroom. So, no, that student is really a case. Okay, but you see, you use the same word, spelled exactly the same way, and pronounced the same way, but how you use it different, okay. Now, this is about exactly how words are associated with other words. Okay, and then here, the developmental, the problem most students, in fact, face in developmental education is exactly the language problem. This is the language of the book, okay, CALP. Because here, in college, in order to be successful, all students, okay, whether you speak English as the first language or you speak English as a second language, you will need exactly the language of the book. And this is exactly what Cummings, in fact, say indicate that the second language learners, okay, can develop the CALP in 2 years. But you see, it takes, depending on the motivation and the commitment to schoolwork, it takes up to 4 to 7 years, for instance, to grasp exactly the meaning of the book. The language of the book. Now, the problem with this is that, okay, sometimes I see that maybe are we impatient with our students? Because you see, if you learn, for instance, we have some colleagues in South Yuma County. Okay, they studied Spanish and so they even went to Mexico for a semester and so on. Okay, and then they come back. They started exactly speaking some kind of Spanish and so on. Do you think that if they are schooled in Spanish, can they exactly be writing Spanish the way they are writing English? No, you need to do a lot of reading. Reading is exactly key. It's essential to try to grasp to learn, in order to acquire. You need to read to reinforce that language. Okay, now in college you have two groups. We have those who speak English as the first language, and the second one is the second language. Okay, now we see most of the time when they come from high school, the young students, okay, high school graduates and so we also have older students, or the adult immigrant student. Now, most of the time, young student, those who speak English as a second language, okay, don't receive much ESL due to the ability, to speak conversation English, because this is exactly what it's here in the United States, okay? If you sound American in your elementary school, they can move you up, okay, from second grade all the way to fifth grade. They say, no, he sounds American, he knows English. Okay, now, you go there, you have one thing. You have conversation English, but you are lagging behind the grammatical foundation that you need. And this is exactly causes a problem here in college. So what we have to do is exactly start over again, okay? So to try to reteach you the grammar that you need and the vocabulary of the book, okay? For you to be able, for instance, to compete. Now, there is also a push, okay, for these students to be mainstream as quickly as possible due to financial constraint, okay, financial aid, because it's for a limited time. This is not a bonanza which you just sit there and then you can keep going on in it and use it as you like. Now, okay, now, the grammar and the vocabulary are not developed enough exactly to understand what they are reading, and therefore they can't write well. So in Arizona, ESL students generally receive 1 year of ESL, non-scheduled English instruction, before being placed in regular classes, which is quite short of 7 years, okay? Usually necessary, in fact, to adopt the academic language. So, for adult immigrants, okay, they are placed in ESL program for 2 years. Okay, now, some of them are with good education training, okay, in their home countries, they succeed in picking up the academic language because the concepts are there already. And this is the case, I used to teach in San Luis. You teach engineers and so on. Science has an international language, okay? They know the concept of math and so the only thing they need is just to the keywords, okay? To say, for instance, this is 4 and then plus 4 equals this. But the concept is there already. They just need a word, for instance, to translate that concept. So for them, it's much easier. Now, since most recent to also work to support their families, they may store longer. They may stay longer than 2 years in ESL. As a result, okay, students in this situation end up being lost in ESL or in a developmental pipeline. Okay, now, this is the problem now. How to fix this problem? The easiest way, because look, teachers, what you do is we always strive for excellence. Okay, not perfection. So what you do, we know exactly how to solve our own problem. Here, the easiest way would be this. Just integrate writing and reading as follows. So for English 8 and English 90 should be taught, okay, concurrently with English 9, reading 96 or another reading course, okay, to support each other as per acupressor, because most of the time we ask a student to go there and take the acupressor. That is exactly a good indication to know exactly which level they should go to. Okay, now, pedagogically speaking, integration is sound. Like any language, okay, English has four basic skills, okay, naturally acquired following this order. The listening, speaking, reading, and writing. Now, intuitively or not, these language skills require knowledge and or awareness of words and also basic grammar. This is the basic grammar here, I mean the grammar of a sentence, because we write, we also speak in sentences and we read in sentences. Now, listening and speaking go hand in hand, and so do reading and writing. So the former involve beaks, and then, as we said before, whereas the latter in fact involve the calp. Now, the natural function of words is what? It's exactly to receive, to express, to create, and you create meaning, okay, with the help of grammar. And here, vocabulary is tremendously important to success, okay, both in reading comprehension and also in writing. Now, vocabulary development, okay, really to reading comprehension, enhances, okay, proficiency in writing and helps develop metacognitive and also critical thinking skills. Because if you read without understanding, you don't understand. And if you don't understand, the reading doesn't trigger curiosity or ideas in you. Now, reading supports writing development, and writing increases, okay, phonological awareness, and thus develop reading ability. Now, through reading, students learn the power of words. The strong introduction eventually used such knowledge as they write their own pieces. Now, conversely, writing develop awareness of the structure of a language, the organization of the text and the spelling patterns, okay, which in turn contribute to reading proficiency. And that's why they really reinforce each other. This is kind of a two-way street. Okay, now, reading, as a matter of fact, is composing. It's a composing process. This is the composition of a particular form of a social practice, okay? That validates, okay, some students includes others. Now, readers, okay, construct meaning from the text rather than passively internalize it. Now, why we need to know the convention, the structure, the intention of particular discourses to produce language, we likewise need some knowledge to comprehend them. And then, see, though we don't always read to write, because see, most of the time we don't read to write. If you enjoy reading, what you do, you pick up a book, you can easily enjoy, for instance, a nice story and so on. However, we always read, okay, when we write, whether you like it or not. We always read when we write, at least if you write science, you need to know exactly, read and understand what you are writing. Now, college students always read about, from, and through others' material after reading. Now, therefore, doing one without the other is not pedagogical sound. In fact, one repertoire of discourse skills is always built slowly and comprehensively through reading and writing. Now, moreover, a major skill in academic writing is a complex ability to write, okay, from other texts. And this is exactly what we do with the student, okay? They read the text and say, okay, summarize or disambiguate, okay, key notions and useful facts and incorporate them in one's own writing. So you kind of reacting, okay, critical to the prose of others. Okay, now, this is about concluding thoughts. So look, segmenting reading and writing is a kind of a disservice to our student in a general education program, where students, in fact, need to read and write to learn. So to integrate and also critique and to basically comprehend. This can only be best achieved, okay, when reading and writing are integrated. Now, segmentation, in fact, betrays the complexity of linguistic discourse and leads to a misconception of the discourse structure. Now, instead, integration is exactly the learning community of the future. Now, this is exactly how you proceed. I always proceed this way because in order to make students exactly feel comfortable, okay, I ask them the questions or the questions like this. What do you need to know in order to understand, speak, or read and write in any language? Because they have a language. And you see, the language they have is no different, in fact, from English. They are all languages. They are all part of world cultural heritage. Because no one can claim any language to be his or hers. Why? Because all of us come to this world with no language. This is exactly linguistically proven. Okay, and it's not because your parents have English as the first language that you are going to have necessarily, you need necessarily to speak English as the first language. It all depends on where you grew up. And then there's also a difference between speaking a language as the first language and knowing how to read and write in a language, because you see, here you have two different operations, okay? When you acquire, for instance, the first language, okay? This is about BICS, but you may be schooled or taught, okay, how to read and write in a different language. The new language becomes your primary language.
It's not much of a question. It's more, I guess, a reflection, a comment. I liked what you said about having the classes separated and being a service to the students, because what you're stating right there is reflected in what is going on in public education at this moment. When I was going to school, the reading and writing class was one. You know, you go to your language arts. And when I first started teaching, like 9 years ago, I like the idea. I love the name language arts, because it's not language as an art form.
Yeah.
And now it's been reduced to reading one class and writing for another.
Yeah.
And this is in all public education. And that bothers me because, for example, there the reading is necessary to integrate into writing and vice versa. That means, for example, for me to write a book or to write an essay, I need to read other writers. I need to read their styles of writing and practice and copy the style. And if it didn't work, we'll change it afterwards. And so I like what you said about actually combining those elements, because it's so essential, and especially, and it's nothing against the community that we live in right here, but because I'm happy to have bookstores here. Thank God for that. But when I where I grew up in the Central, there was one bookstore, like in the entire Pura Valley. People didn't read as they should. And I'm not saying to read a book each month, but to be exposed to different literature. So to see that unification of both reading and writing again, to put that together, I like the idea. I really do. My only question is, when it comes to, for example, combining English 80 and English 90, for the student to proceed to the next level, and from what you're stating, they should be able to take both classes at the same time as a requirement. Okay.
Look, see, as I recall, when I got here in 2002, I used to teach one class here. It was English 95. It was English 95 and 96 at the same time. We used to use the same book. Okay, you go half the semester, you finish English 95, and then after that you continue. You used to have six credit hour. You understand? You see, and then after that the breakdown came. I don't know for what reasons. Okay. But you see, if you read it, if you try to integrate, because this is exactly what it is in community colleges or in Baltimore. So what they do is this: they always integrate reading and writing exactly together. And then what they do is this: they don't go by a textbook. They have they ask. It's what they use is autobiography by Malcolm X. Okay, the same book. You use the same book for reading and also for writing, okay? If you teach that stuff, you need to come up with the questions, okay, after each chapter. And then the tutoring and everything is exactly integrated within class hours. You see what I mean? So you just integrate exactly everything within class hours. And then it's exactly a kind of a massive stuff. And then you see that way the students are going to learn words, and words are recycled, okay, through reading and writing, because they are going to write about the book, and the words exactly say everything will come from the text itself.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Thanks, Betty. And I really liked what you had to say about, and I totally agree about the need for reading and composition to be combined, because what we're really talking about, especially at these developmental levels, is teaching literacy. That's what we need to do, and that involves reading and writing. One of the things that you mentioned, that there's two groups of language speakers. There's your native first language speakers, and then there's your ESL second language L2 speakers. But we also have Generation 1.5 speakers.
Yeah.
Right. So it's much easier to teach literacy to a L2 student who has full literacy in their native language and full literacy to a student who, you know, is a L1, right? So mm-hmm. it's much easier to transfer that than for the generation 1.5 students who don't have literacy in either of their languages.
Exactly.
And that is the majority of our students here.
Yeah.
Which is why I think it's so important that we try our hardest and take some of your suggestions to really focus on literacy as the primary focus of English 80 and 90, because without a solid grasp, without solid literacy, there's no moving on to CALP, there's no moving on anywhere unless you've got that solid grasp. So I'd like to see us talk about ways that we could do this that would benefit also the majority of our students, which are those Gen 1.5 students that don't have literacy in any language at all.
Yeah, you're right. You're right because my best students in writing are those mamas, okay, who were schooled in Mexico. So what they do is they can easily transfer the grammatical knowledge of Spanish into English, because if I say, okay, this is the subject, they know the subject.
Yeah. Once you have basic literacy in one language, it's easy to transfer.
Yeah.
But if you don't, you know, if you're one of those kids that's been moved from, you know, started school in Mexico and then moved to San Luis and finished your schooling there, you've not gotten literacy.
Yeah, you don't.
You don't have literacy.
You don't.
Period.
Yeah, you're right.
And so how do we then transfer literacy concepts to those students that don't have literacy in any language? It becomes much more difficult. And I think that's what we're really struggling with right now.
Yeah, that is exactly the challenge.
That population of students, and it's so challenging.
Because
I love the integration of reading and writing, because that's the essence of literacy, of becoming literate.
You see what I do now in English 80 and 90? I have an audiobook, Great Expectation. Okay, I love Charles Dickens. I read a lot about Charles Dickens. So I play that book. Okay, this is exactly what is on now, because I say we've been into that stuff for 2 weeks now, and the rest of the time till the end, till the finals, we are going to read. They listen, and they read, and I told them, listen, don't ask me, okay, what is the meaning of this word. No, you have the computer, you have dictionaries, and so you need to, you have to prepare yourself, okay, to answer my questions. I'm not here to answer any question, because that is part of comprehension. Now, next week, you know, it should be the week after next, I'm going to ask them to go and take the placement test to see, because I have the result of the placement test, okay, when they started. Now, I need to see exactly how much progress they've made, okay, based on the result, okay, that based on the score of the placement, okay, this time around, and then I will see who is making progress and why, because some read and others are kind of they don't enjoy reading and so on. Yeah.
We have one more comment.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah,
And actually, this is directed at Anne Marie as well. I totally agree with you on that aspect, because that's something that I, as a teacher, have encountered at the junior high level and with my own students in English 90 and English 100, where you have students that, from the range of the spectrum of languages, the students that have the first language in Spanish and they have a strong basis, they transfer so quickly.
Yeah.
But then there's ones that are stuck in between. They either don't know English and Spanish very well, or they know little enough that, and this is where it gets frustrating. We have the Acela testing that we have for elementary and public schools. And we have students where I work at that they need more time. They have basic, real good basic communication skills. But when it comes to actually comprehension text, that's where we have to slow down, we take them along, and it becomes difficult. So directed to, as what you brought up, Abedi, what was said, that becomes the crucial point, is that, as you stated before, we don't have a lot of students that enjoy reading that much.
Mm-hmm.
And to foster that, to make it exciting for them, is part of the challenge in that, and of course, having proper text for it. I guess the only question I have is, to have English 80 and English 90, would you just suggest going back to the model that the school had previously, where we just had one textbook for for both transitions?
Well, we only have one textbook, I guess.
Yeah, it's
just the same textbook. See, what we do is this, there are things that we discuss first in English 80.
Yes.
And then English 90, we review that stuff and then we add based on the mistake that they are making. This is exactly what I do, okay?
Yeah.
See, when I grade, I don't use the rubric.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I edit.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in English 18 and 90, it really I re-edit. And mm-hmm. that's because see, one time I tried to do the peer review.
Yes.
It didn't work. Those mama came to say, no, teacher, you are my teacher. I don't want to read my copy. So, okay, I say, well, no, it doesn't matter. So it's really painful, okay,
yeah.
But I have to do it.
Yeah.
I have to edit, okay, this is the right word, and then this and that, and the spelling, correcting exactly everything, the grammar. And then when it doesn't work, I can refer them to how do you call that book?
Exactly,
the book of reference. Now listen, go and do some practices and so on. But you see, now we are also helped by the connect exercises, because that stuff also helps, okay? To some extent, because everything is in this exactly on the blackboard, they can go there and do the exercises and so on. Some, almost all of them have finished. But you see, it's kind of the result is really the majority, in fact, passed. Mm-hmm. I only have two or three in English. It should be in English 80 in Somerton, mm-hmm. and two in English 90 in San Luis, and one also in English 80 in San Luis who kind of failed. He got 60, 62, or something like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Hello, my name is Kevin Urbina. I'm an SI leader here with the Student Success Center in a writing intensive class. And my essay for the symposium is it's about how to come more closely to a thesis using literary devices. And first I'd like to say that we have an excellent English department, and it's an honor to be here with you, and I believe you're all doing a very good job at training us as students. Mm-hmm. And hopefully you can take something out of this and maybe implement it into a lesson or two. I believe it really helps. It's helped me. It's helped me. And with my experience as an SI leader, it seems that students, I think they do know what they want to say. Maybe they just don't know how to put it concisely into a sentence or two, what we know as a thesis. And so I think that for students to learn through writing, there's two ways to write. That I've learned so far. Maybe there's more. Hopefully there's more. But so there's the there's the thesis support, also known as the five paragraph essay. And then there's what I learned here at AWC, the inquiry-driven essay. And I think that for students to learn through writing, there's many ways, but they tend to use what's familiar to their culture, including grade school culture. And I want to say that the arrival at a thesis is an epiphany, to put it concisely. If a student is familiar with creative writing, then it can be said that their thesis is their epiphany. And the ways of writing can be related to structure and organization of an essay. And what I mean by that is kind of like similar to plot structure. I'll begin with that literary device. As you may know, plot, it's essential in progression of a story. It's also essential in how your essay progresses. The five-paragraph essay, the thesis support, I'd like to relate it to what's known as in media res in writing. It looks very similar, so similar. You start, in the middle of the action, then you talk about how you got there. It's kind of like it's kind of like being straightforward, like it is with the five paragraph essay. And while the question-driven essay, you can compare it more I'd say, to the dramatic plot structure, where you begin subtly and then you kind of go up to your climax in the final paragraphs, or I think that the way most students and even some instructors are comfortable with are using the thesis support, but like I said earlier, there's other ways to write that, and the thesis support is good for organizational purposes. It lets students understand what they want to write about and organize those thoughts. But to really learn, I think, to really know how to answer questions, they should do the question-driven essay. And I think the way this can be applied to the classroom is that it's vital to teach them both, like I said, for organizational purposes and also to answer their own questions and to look for answers. And so I think that's how teaching students maybe a little about plot can help them organize. Now, in regards to setting, which is another literary device, it's rarely vaguely mentioned. Even in creative writing and in expository writing, there's a purpose to it both. The example I want to use is in Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. If you're familiar with that story, you can see how, when he sets out on his journey, he faces the perils of nature. And it kind of sets the mood. It sets the mood that he's in tough times. Also, when he leaves Bertilac's castle, it's raining. It's cold. It's not vaguely mentioned. It's there for a purpose. It's telling the reader, Gawain is scared. And I think in that way, you can also have writers know that when they describe a setting in their essays, it should be there for a purpose. And I think most students are capable of understanding this. Now, related to their writing, I use the example in the essay. If you want to describe a blue-collar worker, you're probably not going to describe him shopping at a mall, or you're going to describe him with his helmet on in a factory next to loud machinery if you want to describe his struggles. And I think teaching them that can really help students understand the purpose of descriptive imagery in their own essays. And it's something that I haven't really seen being taught in classes. But also, onto the next literary device is characterization. Here at our school, the essays, the prompts you guys assign us, they often involve real people. For example, the personal essay, the profile, the ethnography, and even interviewing others. And I think it's a really good skill for them to know how to do characterization. It may even be easier to teach them to do characterization in expository writing rather than in creative writing. You see, in creative, you have to you have to know your character. You have to think like your character and think how would they react in certain situations. And you have to keep up with it as the story goes on. In expository writing, it's a little simple. It's more simple. You observe a few characteristics of your character, what you want to highlight. Then you hunt those characteristics in their behaviors. You hunt for it. You look for it. So you can put it into your essay. And that way, I think that showing them how to do characterization will really set them up good for describing their subjects in essays that involve real people. And so that's it regarding characterization. And so plot setting and characterization, they're vital elements to the theme of a story. And I think that I really strongly believe that the theme of a story can be seen as the equivalent of a thesis in expository writing. And but not all students are familiar with these two writing styles that I brought up. And I think these writing styles are very common in American higher education. And but most are familiar with storytelling. You can take a student from anywhere, and they'll know how to, they'll recognize a story. I think they can even recognize the progression of a story. And even if they don't know the names of the terms, so. Make them familiar with these terms and how to use them in their essays. I think it can really help. And I think that the point of this strategy that I'm suggesting is to to put thesis formation and the basics of rhetoric into kind of into an idea that everyone's familiar with, which is creative writing. And once again, I hope this helps you guys. And thank you for what you guys do to us and teach us.
Well, let's open to any comment or questions. You're still in the hot seat.
I just wanted to say I love it. I think it's a great idea and had never thought of using, in all the many years I've been teaching, had never thought of using literary device to teach expository writing. And I think it's such a brilliant idea, and I'm going to start doing it next semester. So thank you. So if you've got any suggestions for how to work that into assignments, come and see me and let me know.
Okay.
Another question. We'll start here, and then we'll move across here.
Uh-huh. First, a compliment. I really enjoy it. I really love the fact that you took a moment to, a huge moment. I'm sure this wasn't easy to go through because you had to go through experiences and so forth. This is just amazing. The only thing, I guess, it's more of a comment and observation that this is things that I thought about when I was teaching. Because like this past semester, teaching English 90, having the students write a narrative story, I think about how can I incorporate teaching these elements and not lose the class time. And that's a tricky thing, but it is possible. And once you're able to do that, it helps so much. It really does. But to make it more, sorry about that. But I also agree with Anne-Marie that at times, you know, to incorporate these elements with expository text, you don't think about it too often. What you're proposing is a really good idea. So just my congratulations. This is well done.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Congratulations. I remember seeing you, I think in San Luis, you were in Anne-Marie's class, I guess. Yes or no? Yeah, you know, yes or no? Yeah, this is exactly a good job. Now, listen, you see, I find this exactly very, very interesting. See, when you write here, where is that? Here. See, you're talking about, for instance, setting. Mm-hmm. Exactly on page one, that is the last sentence. Okay, setting is vital to storytelling. Okay, which is really good because here you have to take it. You have to take into account when, where, but also the culture around. Okay, because you see, culture is very dynamic. It's not static. It really changes exactly over time. And also the last sentence here. This is I love it. Okay. And that the question is no longer about relating data, but about gathering data. Okay. That is exactly. This is very, very good. I mean, this is exactly what we do. For instance, when I ask my students when they in English 102. Okay. They go there. Okay. Not to relate that, but they have to know how to. Gather there. Okay, this is very, very good. This is really perfect. Okay, congratulations and keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. Do you have any final comments, or did you have a question?
I have one question, real quick.
Yeah. Okay.
thank you.
Yes.
So if I want to use this in a class, I'm thinking that starting a story that starts with the climax. Can you suggest a movie that students would be familiar with that starts with the climax, or anybody?
A movie? Did you say a movie that starts?
Yeah, a movie, because something students would know to kind of illustrate the concept of starting a story at the climax.
Mm. A movie? Well, I'm not really a big movie fan, but.
I'll just hold up my tongue where you start. It's the circular. You start with major action happening, and then you end up how they got there. Almost like Memento is one that's coming to mind, but you wouldn't want to show that in class, I don't think.
The DreamWorks mastermind is not a great example, but the climax of the story is where he begins the narration.
Exactly.
I do remember one actually, and well, perhaps it's one that maybe isn't this is not that appropriate to a class setting, but perhaps you'll be familiar with the idea. Are you familiar with the movie American Me?
Oh. Yeah,
so he begins actually by reciting a poem in the movie. He's telling a poem of how he ended up in jail or in prison. And so he's just there reciting that, and it, I guess he's being transferred to another facility. But then after maybe that initial 7 minutes, it starts with flashbacks of his childhood, and the troublemaking they all did, and then it goes on kind of in the middle. Then it picks off where it began, and then it continues on. So I think that's the one that I think you can use. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yay, all right. Something I do with my high school students every day. They're finally catching on. My name is Dave Hanna, hello. I've had the opportunity to speak with many of you before, get to know you. For those of you who don't know me, I obviously teach here at AWC, but I also teach at the high school. And actually, I left them this morning in the middle of the class to come here. So they were wondering where their teacher went. They're sitting there all alone, probably without any clue or guidance right now. And so they're just kind of permanently confused, and they can live with that, I suppose. So I like to think that I have a unique perspective on the educational process. Most students that I meet when they're in 11th grade. I get them for an advisory period, actually, and then I speak to them about their academics, but usually based on English, because that's where my forte is. I'm not going to sit down and talk to them about calculus. I would be a very poor instructor in that area. But I work predominantly every day with seniors, high school seniors, in various levels of English, whether it be advanced placement English or regular run-of-the-mill English, or wherever the circumstance may take me. So I get them right at the very end of their educational career, K-12. And then I see them the very next semester in English 100 or 101, and then usually I see them in 102. So I get this kind of very cool perspective where they start off halfway through high school, and then I get to see them develop all the way through the freshman English composition program. And so a number of years ago, I made some observations about this. Right when I started at AWC, I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just going to learn, and then I can make some observations. And one of the things that I began to observe was a kind of inherent fear about something that I've coined language anxiety, and a fear of language. And I don't necessarily mean that they're scared. The students are not scared to speak. The students are never scared to speak if given the opportunity. It's getting them to be quiet that's sometimes the problem. It's more putting themselves in academic circumstances and situations where their knowledge of the language is put to the test, and as most people would do, they shy away from that challenge. So that's what I hope to talk about a little bit today. So normally I would start off with this Elvish saying, but I don't want to kind of spend too much time there. But if I spoke in Elvish to you, you'd all be completely amazed. I wanted to go with Klingon, but I didn't want to sound too aggressive. So I'd be like, why is this guy yelling at us? I don't want to set that tone. So I think Elvish is a very pretty language, but it basically translates to this. Good morning, well met. A star shall shine on the hour of our meeting. Today, Friday, November 20th, and my name is Mighty Warrior. So I would start with Elvish to try to point out something that if that was the way class was led, we would have some problems. So, if you came to my class expecting to know Elvish, and the expectation was all your work is done in Elvish, and so on, you would stop coming into class very quickly. You would find another class instead of seeking out that challenge. Or even if the class was partially required to be that way. So, language anxiety is a result of a language barrier. That's what it boils down to. Thank you very much. No. Language barrier grows to language anxiety through skill set degradation. As some of our earlier speakers mentioned, if they don't practice it continuously, they forget it. They don't strengthen it. It's like any well-tuned muscle. And I'm not going to go into the long-term effects of this because I want to focus on predominantly the academic aspect, but it can lead to death. So if you can imagine, did you feel ill reading that Elvish? Probably not, because your life is not dependent on it. You may have watched Lord of the Rings, and maybe that's about it. Or you went to Berkeley and you majored in Elvish, which you can actually do. But let's not focus on that. What, if your future hinged on that, like I mentioned, though, you would have some problems. But what if you only had a partial understanding of the English language, and that is the medium in which all our classes are taught, with the exception of the foreign language classes, of course. This is the challenge that our students face. They face the challenge of having a partial understanding of the main language, and data shows it terrifies them. It really does. And I see it in the eyes of my students when I see them in the high school level, because there is a Arizona in terms of its ESL, and I heard you mention Azella earlier actually, that the whole program for SEI instruction in Arizona is fairly weak. And as a result, it begins to show. And I have a lot of students, in fact, my wife actually, she works with freshmen in sciences actually, she sees it more often than I do, because at a younger age they've had less opportunity obviously. And they are starting to even put students into her class that have not spoken a word of English in their entire lives, and here they are now in a freshman biology course. Right, so we see it. You know, they're terrified just to ask to go to the bathroom. And then when they do, it's like this moment of marvel because, you know, they finally found the confidence. They will not go to the teacher and try to struggle. They'll not do the pee-pee dance, or they will not point. They'll shake and they'll send a friend up. So this is not something that is made up. This is something that at the high school level we see. We don't see so much at the college level, at least in terms of the visual cues, because as we get to adults, we're a lot better at hiding our fears and our anxieties. That, and we're not required to show up to class, so we can, you know, put it off as an illness. That video is actually called How English Sounds to Non-English Speakers. I guess they had some insight on it, and they do a lot of wonderful language-based videos. But in their case, we were able to pick up the occasional word, and then the words that we were picked up had no real, shall we say, context to them. They were just kind of random words that had no meaning to us. Unfortunately, this is how a lot of students approach language if they don't have English as their first language. So if you take away from the video, we understood certain words. We certainly understood the tone. It was a jovial tone at the start, one of friendship. If we watch it later on, it gets kind of angry, actually, and the girl ends up stomping away crying for reasons we don't know. We want to know, what did this man do to you? But we have no idea. She's holding a cake. It's very, you know, esoteric. So we understood tones, we understood the gist of the plot, but that was about it. If we wouldn't be able to pass a quiz on that, or write a paper, or discuss it, and we couldn't enhance skill sets because we had no idea what the thing was about. We could say, oh yeah, that makes sense. We can kind of nod our head and understand, but we don't actually know. We just pretend that we know, and we try to get by. Then that way, when the academics come up, it becomes a problem. So this is the challenge that our students face, I believe. So applying this to our area, we all know that English acquisition is not the strength of many of the members in our community. This is not a fault, of course. It is simply language. In Arizona, 27% of residents have a first language other than English. In southern Arizona, where we live, that jumps up to 54%. And so that does not necessarily mean 54% of all students have language anxiety, but it is a number to be considered. So signs of it, diagnosing it if we want to become kind of temporary doctors. A student that feels or has language anxiety issues there, I don't think it's going to zoom in, no it won't, it's just going to skip it altogether. So we'll go back real quick. Over here by Lynn Horwitz, it's the feeling of tension, apprehension, nervousness, and worry associated with an arousal of the autonomic nervous system when confronted with a foreign language. There we go. Thank you. words. It's the Gatorade this morning, I promise. So, in other words, when faced with a foreign language, they have some issues with it. And again, working with seniors, I actually get the kind of the opposite problem when they start speaking about their Spanish classes, because they're confronted with the foreign language. When they're seniors, their graduation depends on them passing the foreign language. And I think we see it an awful lot in those classes more than anything else. So, you know, they're not going to be, you know, shaking like, oh my God, what am I, they're not going to be like that. No, that would be ridiculous. Nobody in their right mind would go to a public circumstance or situation where they have that. So a causal link exists between those who suffer from language anxiety and then in the overall classroom and workplace. So, just a couple of more symptoms or signs here. This is a chart. This chart is actually getting somewhat out of date now. I should probably replace it. But if you take a look here, this was the sample size. Prezi is letting you know that it is in full screen. Usually about 539. There's a couple of variances down here at the bottom. But of that survey, students who took the survey were asked, "What, you know, check off the things that you would have some difficulty doing." The number one thing was giving a speech. And that's not just true of language anxiety. That's true of a lot of people. You know, I think somebody once said that the number one fear a person has, or most people have, is public speaking. Number two is death. People would rather die than actually give a public speech, you know. The other one here, and this is the one that we should pay particular attention to, is being with a group of strangers. All right, they're no longer at the high school level when they get to us. They haven't gone through school with the same people for 12 years. They're in a completely different circumstance, completely different campus, different instructor, different group of students of various academic abilities and backgrounds. And not nearly, but 40% of them had a problem with that. And then it goes down asking for a date. I don't imagine that's going to be one of the things here, although the Yuma Sun did rank AWC as the number two place to find a date. The number one was jail. So there you go. Now, granted, this was 3 years ago, but Yuma's best. It reveals things about the community that you never imagined. Crowded places, saying something stupid, new places, interviews, and then expressing your feelings, and then talking to, I think we'll go outside and make sure, is it to a professional, I believe, an authority figure, so in our case, us. So all these things, you know, in some way or the other, with the exception of, you know, asking for a date, really are things that we have to take some concern about. Just some more symptoms of it, which we're not really focusing on right now. But the symptoms, they do manifest themselves in classrooms, at homes, in dreams, everywhere you can imagine. So what is the cause of this? What can we do to reduce it? What can we do to help our students? I mean, this is not a matter of acquisition. This is a matter of them not knowing it. The acquisition in some point in time has not worked for them, yet they're still facing these academic circumstances. And whether we can sit and we can say to them, well, you should have learned this. I feel like saying that an awful lot with my 102 students. You should have learned that in 101, or my 101 says, you should have learned that 100, or wherever it was that you came from, or high school, which seems kind of really weird if I'm saying you should have learned it in high school, but I didn't teach them it myself. It's an awkward moment. But the point is, you know, we can say that. We can say, well, it was the previous teacher's fault. That does not actually help us. The point of the matter is they're with us, they have these issues, and we have to do something, what we can about it. So the kind of turns more psychological here. That's the technical background behind it. Word association, sound association, linguistics, knowing and meaning sounds, and so forth, are all part of the technical background of acquisition, but somewhere along the line that is broken down for them. It has not worked. It could be simple sound replacement, P versus B sounds, and D, I suppose, is another one you throw in there, though P and B have that more aggressive sound to it. But, I mean, it's for us, even though, and I saw I looked at your faces there as I was watching, and some of you were kind of laughing, and I saw a couple of quizzical looks on some faces there. Think about the backgrounds we have, right? We're having trouble with that level. But if you keep it, take it down a little bit, you know, reduce the language a little bit, but then for our students, you've got to reduce their background, all right, to the English language. And I'm not saying it's a steady step, of course, it's an erratic process, but their understanding of some of the words we use is problematic. And that's something I've learned both at the high school and at the college over the last couple of, actually it's more than a couple of years now, over a while, I have learned that word choice is everything. We want to use academic language wherever we can, but whenever we do, we run the risk of our students not understanding us on a regular basis, combined with the fact that many of them have been dealing with language anxiety issues for most of their educational careers. It creates a rather large problem by the time they walk through our doors into our classrooms, into our lecture halls, or wherever it is that they come along with us. So the academic issues, there's a natural defense for these students is to withdraw from the painful encounters and isolate themselves from the world around them. We all have students that they come to our classrooms for the first little bit and then we never see them again. And I mean, I'm not suggesting that they ran away from because of anxiety issues. Some of them, they couldn't take the time anymore. They thought the class would have been too hard. It could be a number of things. But I've also had the luxury of starting to work with online students, especially in 102. And after the first paper, I only have three papers in that course, three very large research papers. After the first paper, I get a great deal of emails from students talking about their future in the course. And they say, well, you know, I turned this first paper in, but I feel like I have no idea what I just did. And I said, well, that hurts, because that means I've let you down as an instructor. But the point is, I get to have this conversation with them, like, what exactly was the issue? You know, sometimes it was the workload. They thought it was maybe a little too much for work, or they thought maybe the concepts were difficult, or perhaps I didn't clarify something very well. But every now and again, I get an accessibility factor. I could not access the content. It was too difficult for me to understand. And I said, well, what do you mean? And they don't say language directly. They don't say the language was difficult. But that's what it boils down to. And I can only imagine if that's the trouble I'm having in the 102 online, then that's the same problem I'm having with my 102 in person, my 101 in person, my 100 in person, and my high school students. So I'll wrap up here pretty quickly. We don't need to make the leap to social anxiety. I just want to kind of get to what do we do to solve this on the in the short term? Because again, by the time they get to us, we can no longer say, well, go back and relearn it. That's no longer an option. They're with us whether we like it or not. So simply recognizing and being aware of the issue is a start. Support groups. One of the great things that we work with at the high school is putting students together based upon dissimilar abilities. Don't group the best students together to work with the best students and leave the worst to fend for themselves. That's not a very good idea. But put the ones who are struggling with the ones who are excelling. The excel students actually get a chance to work and they get to go to a higher level and so on. Scaffold learning, that's I think just good pedagogy right there. Acknowledge and discuss challenges with the student. Have that conversation. They may have a problem approaching authority figures, but if we seek them out, that makes it that much easier for them. And lastly, and this is the most difficult, reevaluate our teaching beliefs. A lot of times we're just content to say, well, you know, you're in college now, you should have learned it. And that's really not going to serve as our students well as they proceed to grapple with these challenges. So that is, in conclusion, right there, it's a problem and we should solve it, obviously. But how we do that is up to us on, just solve the problem and I will be well. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Questions and comments from the floor? Coming over here.
I just want to say thank you. That's great. And I recognize so much of this from my own encounters with students here. You were, you know, one of the things that you were talking about with the autonomous, nervous responses with anxiety is it this language anxiety thing. It's not just like a mental, I'm lazy, I don't want a thing. It's a very physical thing for students. It's a very real and physical, difficult thing for students. And I think that a lot, like you were saying, well, you didn't learn it. Well, now it's your responsibility to go learn it. I think that we really do them a disservice, like you were saying, when we take that attitude. So I really think that that's amazing that you brought that up. Thank you. And then when you had that matrix scene, I do a section with all my 102 students on academies. Mm-hmm. That's what I call it, or ingfish is another term for it. This is what you don't want to sound like, right? Yeah. This is what all the academic papers that you're going to, do you remember this? This is what all the academic papers that you're going to read for your sources are probably going to sound like. This is not what you want to sound like, right? Yeah. No one wants to read this. So yeah, we call it academies or ingfish, and it's banned. We're not allowed to do it, right?
If I may, it's what I love about actually Ballinger, who does The Curious Writer and Researcher. He has a wonderful section on that about keeping it simple, keeping it straightforward to the point. If the point of research is to communicate ideas, to come up with a new understanding based upon your research data, don't be like what you just read.
Exactly.
You know. Instead, the best way to communicate a point is to be as simple as possible. And I always point out, you know, eyewitnesses on news programs and the local news. They're these people who clearly have not had much of an education, yet they're out there being interviewed as if they have, you know, the most complex vocabulary because they're trying to show off. They're trying to sound formal. And I ask the student, well, why? What does that do for you? It makes your point more confusing, more complex. And I just had that conversation with one of the advanced placement students that I have at the high school who thinks he can earn more points by using the most complicated, you know, 7-syllable words he can find. Yeah. And it doesn't serve us.
There's a really interesting website, too. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's, I can't remember the name of it, but it's basically a group of faculty get together and vote on the worst sentences or passages that were written in academia that year.
Have you
seen
it?
It's the annual, isn't there an annual worst sentence of the year?
It's something like that, but it's specifically for academies. Oh. And I mean, it's some very respected authors show up in there, some that I was shocked to see. But you read these to the students, and it's like, what? I don't even know what this means, yeah. Right? How do we translate this back into English?
Right.
Now, you know, so yeah. that obviously is a cause of language anxiety, because this is what they're seeing confronted with. Now I have to interact and dialogue with this. I don't even understand what this is saying, you know? How do I do that? And then, you know, your point about that, you know, the reactions that you get from students, whereas in college we don't see them with the you know, shaky, the nervousness. Mm-hmm. What I do see is, you know, when you have students write reflection papers, I have them write a reflection mm-hmm. letter to me before every essay, and every essay, all with some exception, almost every single reflection letter starts off with an apology.
Yes.
And that right there breaks my heart, mm-hmm. because why would you start off with an apology? Or, I'm terrified of what you're going to think of this. I'm so sorry you have to read this horrible paper. And it's because of language anxiety. Mm-hmm. It has nothing. They never say my ideas are bad, my this is bad. There's going to be so many grammatical errors in here, and I don't know if I chose the right words. And it's just, it's heartbreaking to see that when... I'm grateful that they're that authentic, but it's heartbreaking to see that they start off with an apology to a faculty, you know, to something I'm excited to read.
Or
they just give brilliant, up on it. Yeah. Brilliant. Thank you so much.
As we transition the microphone, my English 100 students from the very last paper on the day of the final, I say, okay, I'm gonna score you, I'm gonna give you feedback on your final essay right now, before you leave this room, because otherwise you'll never get to see it. And it's some of the most cringeworthy reactions, you know, for whatever reasons. And they say, oh, it sucks. They already defeat themselves before it even begins.
Exactly.
Okay. I just want to pick up from Anne-Marie. Now, listen, don't we have also language anxiety teachers? If you just, teaching is not a picnic. You don't just walk into a classroom and start teaching. Mm-hmm. If you didn't prepare. Because language, as a matter of fact, teaching or learning in everything is exactly language teaching or language learning. Now, if you are not prepared for instance to do something, don't you have language anxiety when you walk, for instance, in a classroom, you don't know what to say mm-hmm. or what are we going to talk about?
That's why teachers everywhere, they can't sleep the night before the first day.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
Say, what kind of kids am I going to get? Yeah. What do I need to say or be like? And then that's in the gradual adaptation process as each one goes on. Yeah.
Yeah.
Teachers are nervous too.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course, but we can channel it better, you know, with the experience eventually.
All right, so I'm glad you brought this up. This is really great. I really enjoy it because a couple things. It's not more a question, but more observation and sure. a comment on it. Is teaching at the junior high, this and at here mm-hmm. at the college, is quite fascinating because it affects students' behavior, not just anxiety level, but participation in class, where you have a student who may not care and say, okay, I don't have good English, but that doesn't matter. But the majority do care. And I guess it goes to the point of having the language become a reflection of identity. And it goes for me, it goes in both ways. Because when I speak to my students, I try to use a bit higher level vocabulary so they can get accustomed to it. And if they have questions, I'll tell them, okay, oh, it means this or it means that. But of course, I wonder, and like Avedi brought up, is a bit of language anxiety because it then becomes, do they understand me? Do they understand the assignment? Okay, I'm going to repeat the assignment one more time. And that becomes part of it. And then it goes in reverse, not reverse, but goes to the other side of Spanish. Because of being a Mexican American, I'll have open house and I'll speak in Spanish. And I'll make really bad choices in the words I use. Not inappropriate words, no. But more of using the improper pronunciation or improper word. And I'm thinking, oh gosh, did I just embarrass myself in front of the students' parents? They understand. It's okay. I'm fortunate. I'm fine. But it's something that I think it hits to everybody because when it comes to language, it's it can be stressful because so often we're judged based on it. And I guess this goes to a question. Do you think that the students' perceptions of the teachers fills their anxiety if they perceive this teacher to be supposedly this wealth of knowledge that they feel as if their language is inferior and that kind of feels that anxiety as well?
In both the high school and the college classes that I teach, there's a lot of reading.
Yeah.
And that's why I was very appreciative of actually your presentation earlier that combines both reading and writing together because it is a crucial skill. And that's why, again, Ballinger is another good choice for books, as is the General Patterns book for 100, actually. But whenever it comes to the high school level, you know, for the first part of my career, I was like, don't you dare make a mistake, because the students are going to think lesser of you for it. But I've learned over time that the students, they feel better, actually, if they know that we're human. And that you don't have to be perfect. Yes. You know, it is, in language, I mean, language is an imperfect process. It's always changing. I mean, we're using emojis as word of the year now, right? That's how we should just communicate, just emojis now. But why not? It combines both feeling and words, and it does so in a cute picture that you can then kind of look at. So for these kids, you know, whatever level it is, if you let them know that you're struggling with something, I get this with writing as well, because there's a separate thing with writing anxiety as well. That's kind of an extension of language anxiety, but it's more generalized to writing one is. I share with students of all levels, I say, look, introductions, they are the hardest thing for me to write. And the kids never really respond to that, but every now and again, mom will say, I'm glad you said that, because now I know it's okay. You know, that I'm not a lesser person for not being able to write an introduction or a thesis statement or whatever part of the essay they might be struggling with. If we're open with our challenges, and if I'm not saying that we purposefully make mistakes, but if we say, oh, I've made a mistake there, you know, that's why if students correct me in class, oh, you misspelled that word, oh, thank you, you know. I don't say, how dare you, you insolent child. I tell them, you know, thank you for letting me know, because as soon as you say that, you know. So the short answer is it's okay for us to make mistakes, and it really benefits, I think, the students as well. Because if we're having trouble, then they feel all right.
I agree with you completely, and I'm glad to hear that, because it's interesting working at the junior high level, and I've worked at the high school level right. As well. There are many teachers that have that complex of saying, I have to be perfect. And then, like, after a few years of teaching, I realized, I'm going to tell the truth. Sorry, kids, I don't mind the spelling. I spelled it wrong. Oh, we'll take care of that later. Or say, oh, can you help me correct this? Okay, thank you. You know, I say, oh, you know what? And I tell my students, for me, writing is a painful process. I love writing. But there's moments where I want to punch the screen, where literally it's just, why? It just banged my head on the desk. And I tell that the students laugh, they feel more comfortable, mm-hmm. and they're more open, more receptive to it. So I'm glad you brought that up, and this is really great. So thank you very much for bringing this up. Okay. Thank you.
Final thoughts for you? Oh, sorry, you have a question, and then your final thoughts.
Already defeating yourself, language anxiety taking over, right?
It's not a question. Oh. It's important, though.
Oh, right.
So when my students see that I've made a mistake on the board, like instead of writing the word boyfriend, I write boy fiend, I thank them so much for being awake.
Yeah.
You're awake!
You're clearly paying attention.
And I give them an extra credit right away. Yeah. And I tell them where it's going to be applied. Anyway, yeah.
It wasn't a mistake.
And then I get to explain what Freudian slip is. And then I make all kinds of mistakes, yeah.
Thanks, Jeff. Again, final thought.
Since that's kind of what we're gravitated towards, you know, there's a great character in science fiction who was known for saying, I'm a doctor, not a whatever.
Oh, yes.
Say, I'm an English teacher, not a dictionary. Yeah. Thank you very much.
My name is Anne Marie, again, Anne Marie Thweet. I'm a professor of English, and until next year, for one more semester, I'm the writing specialist for the English department and the campus. But primarily, I'm an English teacher, so, okay. And basically what I've written about here is writing in the first person, why I love it so much, and why I think that all students from English 80 through English 102 should be writing just about everything they write in first person. So, the title is Engaging the First Person Industrial Complex in Freshman Composition, Why I is Important. Lately, I've noticed more and more writers publishing in academic journals, admittedly mostly in the humanities and first person. When I want a current model reading for my students, almost invariably what I find is written in first person. Full disclosure, I like first person writing. I like reading it. I like having my students write in it. But it's not just as simple as a style preference. It's really more of a content preference, an authenticity preference, an accountability preference, a full disclosure preference. And I have a feeling that's why it's catching on in academic journals. Credibility. As we all know, first-person writing has long been the internet's native voice. And now, we are officially in the area of the first-person industrial complex, as applied to the internet, which is also the title of the wonderful essay in Slate by Laura Bennett. I recommend you all read it. It's an excellent essay. Her essay warns of the potential dangers to authors, young authors, our student authors, the potential dangers to authors, especially young authors, the danger that they face given the internet's seemingly insatiable desire for that worst moment of my life, first-person essay. And young students are giving those essays up like crazy to be published on the internet. She also, Bennett, laments what most of these first-person essays are lacking: any sense of meaningful self-awareness. This is the great strength of the personal essay, the first-person essay, if well done. Self-awareness. Self-awareness begets credibility in writing in all walks of life. Self-awareness begets credibility. But self-awareness isn't the only great strength of the first-person essay. And please note, when I say first-person essay, I don't just mean personal narratives, okay? My summer, or the worst moment of my life, or, you know, a personal narrative. I mean all essays that we would teach in freshman composition: research essays, argumentative essays. When I say essay, I mean it in the broadest sense. First-person writing, good first-person writing, is an incredibly complex skill. It takes not only keen self-awareness, but also loads of critical thinking. Bennett says the best first-person essays arrive at the thesis or central message by guiding us through the precise arc of their self-reckoning. This is a very difficult feat to manage, to guide your reader through the arc of your self-reckoning, right, to your epiphany, if you will, your thesis. This is a difficult feat to manage, right, and requires a set of skills that our students need to be taught. They need to master, not only to be successful in their first-person writing, but for their disciplinary third-person objective writing, which they will surely be tasked with in their WI disciplinary writing courses. I put objective here in quotation marks, okay, because we so often, especially in the English department, I've noticed, use the phrase third-person objective writing, okay? However, objectivity has a very different meaning in a biology course than it does in a philosophy course, right? Or in an English course, for that matter. So by teaching the skills of successful first-person writing, what we're teaching for is we're teaching for transfer. We're teaching for transfer into those disciplinary writing courses by teaching them to use first-person writing successfully. The skills required for successful first-person writing, namely that it's authentic, credible, authoritative, and self-aware, are incredibly complex and cannot easily, these skills cannot easily or possibly be tackled in that one-shot, first-person, personal narrative that we all do at the beginning of 101 or 100 or whatever. We cannot possibly teach those complex skills in that one-shot assignment. It's just not possible. In fact, I argue that every essay in 102 as well ought to be written in first person, as well as every essay in 101. How can a student learn, practice, and master positioning herself with a topic in one assignment? How is that possible? To learn, practice, and master positioning themselves with a topic in one assignment. It's not possible. The topic of which, if we're talking about the narrative essay, is herself, okay? We haven't even begun to talk about positioning herself with another topic, right? That may not be so quite so personal, yeah? How can a student, oh yeah, okay, so what about examining, for example, personal bias? Isn't that something that's important that we teach our students how to examine and understand personal bias? What about, how is that going to happen if not through argumentation and research? How are you not going to examine your own personal bias if not through argumentation on a point and research on a point, right? Or other complex skills students need to acquire if we want them to leave freshman composition as self-aware, critically thinking writers, okay? We want them to learn, we want them to leave freshman composition, English 102 or 101. We want them to go out into their WI classes, learning to, already knowing how, but at least being aware of how to examine their privilege or their lack thereof and how that affects their perception of what they see and how they interpret it, right? We want them to learn how that affects their writing and their thinking. We want them to understand subjectivity in a real and meaningful way. We want them to think about different ways of seeing, different ways of thinking. These are important skills to master across freshman composition, but perhaps the most crucial and most neglected place where first-person writing is never used is in English 102, of course, in research and interpreting research, where personal bias, self-awareness, positioning to the subject, lack of privilege, that all comes into play, different ways of seeing. How can we expect a researched essay that's meaningful without any of these things? Building, teaching, mastering, practice, master, right? Where we teach research writing in 102, academic writing, usually requiring students in 102 to write in third person as if that's more academic, okay? In a wonderful paper titled Authority and Invisibility, Authorial Identity in Academic Writing, Ken Hyland argues the merits of first-person academic writing. Academic writing is not just about conveying an ideational content. It's also about the representation of self. Recent research has suggested that academic prose is not completely impersonal, but that writers gain credibility by projecting an identity invested with individual authority, the I, right? Displaying confidence in their evaluations and commitment to their ideas, the I. Perhaps the most visible manifestation of such an authorial identity is the use of first-person pronouns and their corresponding determiners. And this is in academic writing. This is a trend that we see happening more and more in academic journals, first-person writing, because authenticity begets credibility. By neglecting to teach and spend sufficient time in teaching the complex, and these are not easy skills, examining personal bias, examining privilege, right? Positioning yourself with a subject, these are not easy skills to master. Self-awareness is difficult. Self-awareness for a freshman in college is very difficult, right? I mean, this is really the first time they're engaging in these kinds of activities. So by neglecting to teach and spend sufficient time in teaching the complex skills that successful first-person writing requires, how can students write successfully in the objective third person for us? How can they? They can't. How can they write a third-person argumentative essay when they haven't thought about or been held accountable for their privilege, their lack of privilege, their personal positioning in relation to the topic, basically their entire identity in relation to the topic? How can they write an objective third-person argumentative essay without examining all of that, without that being part of it? They can't. Are we really preparing students now for interdisciplinary, objective, third-person writing when every topic we can assign them is subjective in nature? We can't assign anything that would mimic real, objective, third-person writing. We're humanities teachers. We're English teachers, right? So my question is, wouldn't we be doing students a far greater favor by guiding them to become more self-aware as writers, by teaching them how to be self-aware, right? Because that's something we have to teach them, is how to be self-aware, what it means to position ourselves with the topic. What does privilege mean? And who has it, right? What is bias? I don't have any bias, right? But yes, you do. We have to teach them how to understand those things and how to be authentic and credible about those things. What it means to be self-aware as writers. We need to teach them that. And what it means to be self-aware as a researcher as well. Why you choose one source over another. Why you pick out one piece of information versus another piece of information. How you interpret that information. That all has to do with self-awareness. Teaching them to think critically. We need to, these are things that good first-person writing does. It teaches them to think critically about their identities as related to any topic they could ever be assigned to write about. Wouldn't we be doing our students a far greater favor by letting them leave English 101 and 102 with those sets of skills than some practice in not using the first person, right? Because really, if our goal in assigning objective third person writing is to prepare students for upper level WI classes where we assume they will encounter such assignments, we cannot possibly do that. We cannot possibly do that if we haven't first taught and practiced the critical writing and thinking skills that the first person writing does not just encourage, but requires. Leave objective or non-objective third person writing for disciplinary courses, as it's a style choice that varies from discipline to discipline. Third person, objective, non-objective is going to look very different in your discipline than it will look in, say, biology or in philosophy. We can't teach them that. It is a stylistic choice that should be left to WI instructors. What we need to send them out with are the skills to then use that stylistic choice while being fully self-aware, credible writers. Yeah? Okay. So, why don't we do the work of sending critically thinking, self-aware writers into those WI classrooms instead of pretending that we can teach them third-person objective writing as a stylistic choice? It's basically my argument. The end.
Questions and comments from the floor.
Ooh, everybody's
As you can tell, it's something I'm very passionate about. Sorry.
Anne-Marie, this is really great. You know why? Because when I read this, it really reminded me of my stylistic course that I took in when I was in college. You see, that stuff is very, very complex. There is no way for us to teach it. People learn it, through reading, research papers and so on. You will know yourself. It's kind of it will become intuitive. Okay, so when you write, you will know exactly which way to go about it, whether to use I or to use the third person. Mm-hmm. So most of the time, the only rule that I was given was this, is that if you want to distance yourself from the topic, use the third person.
Except I would argue with that too.
Yeah,
right?
And then it's still not clear. You see, even say if. They say if.
Yep.
You see, with if, you can say anything you want to say. But you see, somehow or other, The I always implies is because you are the one who is writing.
Exactly, but saying, and this is, you know, one of the crux parts of my argument is because, you know, when I speak with other English professors who do teach the third person, you know, more power to you if you think that's, you know, your place to do that. But to say that I is implied is not the same as the I being there. And being forced to take responsibility for what the I says and reflect on the I, because it's too easy to, well, the I is implied, so I don't really have to take responsibility for the bias in this statement. I can state this as a fact because I didn't say that. One might say, it wasn't me.
Yes, but
right? So the I is implied, but if we're thinking about the mindset of our students who have not been taught these skills necessarily, and these are thought skills, right? I mean, they're not just writing skills. These are skills of self-awareness, of metacognition, which are charged to us by the WPA to teach.
Yeah.
Metacognition. I mean, that's what this is all about. Mm. But metacognition begets a better writer, right?
You're right.
Exactly. Yes, Steve.
I disagree with everything you say. What are you gonna? No. I actually do agree. In 102, that's where I've kind of been settling on the most recent research paper. Obviously, there's a great deal about, you know, personal credibility and getting your thoughts in there. But I wanted to focus on maybe a subset of something that you brought up. Just one of your lines here, by teaching the skills of successful first-person writing, we are teaching for transfer, and I assume you mean to other disciplines.
To other disciplines.
Right.
Yep.
So a general question that comes up as a result of a lot of my conversation at the high school, is it always up to just the English courses here to help them form that identity? Because if we do allow them to have this kind of self-awareness and build up self-credibility that then gets transferred to other courses, well, they're still taking other courses while they're learning, and some students even push off English to the very end. Mm-hmm. So they've already gone through their other disciplines, and then maybe they go on to other fields, and that's fine if they do, and then they're gonna get those WI courses again.
Yep.
But WI is more than just the English classroom, so how can a balance be struck between forming basic self-awareness and cognitive bias and being aware of all those things in the English classroom, whereas in a completely different classroom, A, should they be even focusing on writing in another classroom, and is it just the responsibility of the English teacher to teach writing, or can it be done everywhere?
Right.
And then how do you, if maybe they realize that their identity is more based on strict objectiveness, if they are perhaps a science major or a mathematics major, where that's the mindset that they have, how do you strike that balance?
Well, I think that balance gets struck in a variety of different ways, right? Because there's no way to know where our students are taking their classes and in what order. There's just no way for us to know that. So yeah, I mean, do I think that this is something that should be taught in every class? Absolutely. Do I think that they should be getting these experiences in every classes in some way or another? You know, absolutely. I think in terms of composition, let me go back to, what was your math part? Like, how are versus the maths and the
math and science. I know this is kind of a stereotype, but there are more of the keep the self out of it, because self doesn't really help you solve a math problem.
Exactly.
Or maybe to say that you can't do it.
But that's and that's what, again, what I would say, the striking of the balance is, that's where they learn that type of objective writing. Because even in math and in science, right, where you go on a field trip, say, and you write down observations, and that's direct objective observation right there, everybody's going to notice something different. There's different ways of seeing there, right? And the same thing in a math class. They're not all going to arrive at the problem in the same way. Some are going to take different steps to arrive at the same answer.
So we can have the diversification of answers, but does that necessarily beget the use of I in that particular circumstance?
It would depend on the disciplinary circumstance, right?
To say that I, and I'm with you in this, and I really am.
Yeah. It's cool. It's great.
We got to think about outside the English classroom. You know, they can have this wonderful self-awareness. That may do them absolutely no good when they write up their lab report for a science or a chemistry class.
I would disagree with that.
But that's the whole point is to record data and to use that data to support a hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
And that hypothesis is formed by their own initial writing, but the lab report itself,
mm-hmm.
them understanding that they had something different from somebody else
is not inherently the most important thing. The most important thing in that particular circumstance is gathering the data. Who cares
Absolutely.
If they saw, right, this initial point, who cares if they saw it differently than everybody else in the room? That's not the focus of the writing. The focus of the writing is to present the data.
Well, in that case, the balance would be then you would hopefully have an instructor, like a specialized faculty member there telling them, this is how you observe.
It's technical writing. Absolutely.
Right? I mean, this is how you observe. This is how you do this, right? I mean, then that's not our job as comp teachers to teach them how to do, because I don't know how to do that. You know, I mean, I know how to do some technical writing, but I don't know how to teach a student to write up an objective report of a chemistry experiment per se. Do you know what I mean?
Okay, so I really enjoy this because this is something I do with my English 90 students a lot, where they have personal prompts, where they have to examine, you know, self-reflected moments of, let's say, you know, for example, the first essay they write about is, tell me one day that was really nice for you. It didn't have to be something specific, it doesn't have to be something grandiose or anything. It just be, you know, we stayed and watched TV, but tell me how that occurred. And the reason I bring that up is because it reminds me of connecting what I was talking about with you as well, is those memoir writings. I use that a lot with my students because it's so difficult for them. And I do agree with you because when it comes to memoir writing, to sit down and ask yourself questions such as, why did I go through this? How did this change me?
I notice this and not that?
Exactly. Those are questions that I think, and I do agree with you in some respects in the fact that it can lead to help better writing in other disciplines. Now, I do understand our compatriot there is saying,
David.
Yeah, that same. Like, and I understand his point of view as well because I mean, just collecting data. But then I think about also interpretation.
Exactly.
And I bring this reflection with somebody that I know. He's a very good friend of mine, and we were discussing about Santeria. And his interpretation, what he saw and what I saw, was completely divergent, different. Mm-hmm. When he saw Santeria, and I told him some aspects of it, he said, it's devil worship. It's like, no, it's not. It's, you know, it's African practices that are brought here by the slaves and then mixed with Catholic practices so they can hide it from the slave masters. And now something unique on its own. Mm-hmm. And it's similar to voodoo in some respects, but there's a lot of differences as well. Mm-hmm. But he kept on ranting, says, no, it's not. And there you have a very direct, objective material, Santeria. And yet, here he and I are arguing about this. And it's like, I'm thinking, don't you get it through your head, you know? But I guess it goes back to how people interpret things and that interpretation. You can have someone...
But then your friend would also have to learn to examine bias. And
exactly.
I mean, so for a small example, one of the things that I do in the first week of 101 is I take students outside, or I'll do it in the classroom if it's a really particularly yucky hot day. What are some of the key elements of the classroom that you observe, right, in this classroom? So everybody, go ahead and write down the first thing that you notice in this classroom. What jumps out at you at this classroom? Everybody. What jumps out at you? What jumps out at you right now? What jumps out at you? Okay, me.
Coffee.
Screen.
Where you and...
Anything.
Yeah, the physical...
One thing. One object.
You see, I'm very broad.
The whole thing for a Betty. Okay.
What those things are.
Those little clippy things.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, what jumps out to you?
Chairs. The lights.
I can't differentiate.
One thing. What jumps out at you first? What's the first thing you notice when you walk in the classroom? First thing you notice while you're sitting here?
Well, you know, Liz is pretty prominent.
Liz, okay. Kevin?
Multiple whiteboards.
Paparazzi over there.
Paparazzi, what do you notice?
The door was unlocked.
Okay, one of the first things I notice when I walk in this classroom is an American flag. Okay, so why do we notice the different things that we notice? And what does that mean, right? Half to a third of my students say that is the first thing that they notice when they walk in the classroom. What does that mean? What does that say? Whereas many notice the teacher, many notice the whiteboard. What does that say about the way you position yourself in the space around you? And that can only be done by first person. I see, I feel, I think, I, you know, do you see what I'm saying?
Do we have one more comment?
Okay, I'm sorry.
I think I'm out of final thoughts.
I just kind of want to circle back, because I think David brings up a really good point about technical writing and scientific writing, and I agree to an extent, because I do have a background in the technical writing aspect. And one of the first things I was shocked, because I started off as a creative writing emphasis, and then when I went into technical writing in graduate school, and the first thing that we did talk about was subjectivity, and that how subjectivity is innate in all human beings. If you don't have subjectivity, you're a robot.
Yep.
Question your humanness. And even in broadcasting journalism, there is a, you know, how many news shows start off with fair, balanced, objective news?
Well, that's, and then you get a different story, a different spin on the same story.
No, there's because the very nature of determining which stories you will cover that day is subjective.
Yep.
The order in which you will cover those stories. How, the length of time you'll spend on each story, what is the focus, what is the topic, who do you interview for that story? Those are all choices we make, whether we're writing a news story, whether we're doing a lab report. How will we determine our research methods when we go to do a lab report?
Yeah.
How will I observe this? What are the circumstances under which I will observe? And most importantly, like you said, the interpretation of the data gathering and the conclusion findings is always subjectivity. It's always subject. So that basically I think what we're circling around to this idea is that subjectivity is a matter of being human. And that for us in the early composition writing classes is just to establish that with our students and to understand that it is there by basically what we call, you know, surveying yourself, surveying your bias, unpacking the backpack. White privilege backpack. But also what I call is another way to look at it is that we all are wearing glasses by which we see the world,
yep.
Our rosy-colored glasses, which build our identities and our self-perceptions. And the first step is to acknowledging that they're there. Well, that's the first step.
And that's
so
a hard
it is
step
mind-blowing,
to make,
right?
Which requires practice,
it requires,
right?
And I'll just give you just a really quick example. I just did this in my 102 class because we do monster culture class, and I've done white privilege before, and it was really hard for them. But instead, this time we read this analysis of Twilight, where the Natalie Willison talks about how the vampires in Twilight are white, wealthy, affluent, educated, and the werewolves are savage. They are Native Americans. They are described as, and she gives very specific examples, they are dark, they are poor, they are uneducated. And then she says, how many millions of Americans solicited, bought that movie, read the book, and then she said, do research, go online and Google, who's Team Edward and who's Team Team, what's his name? Wolf Kid. I'll think of it in a minute, right? And you will see a divide. You will just see a cultural divide on what team they chose, literally. Now, when a white gentleman in my classroom raised his hand and said, well, I think that's just kind of overanalyzing the Twilight story. And three not white students raised their hand and said, I see it. So it was a very interesting discussion, awkward moment, but I think the point was the subjectivity of how do we look at information, but also how do we present information, and then being aware of those glasses.
Exactly.
So I just...
Ms. Thweet, I have a question, and this, I think it may tie back to language anxiety. In some cultures where it's taught like that, using I is selfish, for example, in China where communal ownership is common, where it's the way. How can we teach those students or encourage them to use I more, to not feel bad while using it? This may not be the case for most students, but it's the case for a small percentage of students.
It is, and you're absolutely right that I when you put I in, it's rude to write I. It is rude to write about yourself. And so I think it's through not only having open discussions about those cultural differences in writing, because there are cultural differences in writing across the languages and across cultures, right?
So I think that we have to start by having those kinds of conversations. And then I think it's lots of practice. It's lots of reading, and it's lots of low stakes practice where you're not getting a grade, you're just being asked to write. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
I mean, you had me for 102. How was your experience with writing research in first person?
Well, you did have to I felt that I did have to say a little objective, but sometimes, you know, the subculture does bring you in. They encourage you to participate. And
yeah,
like you said, discussing those cultural differences, inviting them, it does make you more comfortable saying I in paper.
Yeah. And you don't have to do it a lot, right? You just have to acknowledge it. Thank you.
Thank you.